The Grand Circle Tour Podcast proudly presents the weekly roundtable discussion on The Mandalorian. I am Sir Reginald Mantle.
That's not quite what we're looking for.
Grand Circle Tour Podcast. The Mandalorian. Mandalorian.
Mandalorian. Mandalorian.
Mandalorian.
Yeah. No.
Okay, then how about this is the Grand Circle Tour Podcast, weekly roundtable discussion on The Mandalorian.
That's it!
Can I have just one laser hit, please?
That's fine, I guess.
Oh, thank you.
Rising Suns, and welcome to another chapter of the Grand Circle Tour Roundtable discussion. We have our regular Sunday morning bunch here. I have my good friend and yours, Jason. Jason, how are you?
Morning, Stan. I'm great. How you doing?
I am doing awesome. I think I'm more awake than you are this week.
You're usually more awake than me on a Sunday morning.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm a morning person. Also, me are the two. Also with us are the two Clarks. No relation, I don't think. We got Justin Clark and Scott Clark. Justin, how are you?
I'm doing great this morning.
Nice, nice. And Scott, how are you, my friend?
I'm doing great. Good morning.
And there's no relation between you guys, is there, that you know of?
Not that I'm aware of.
No. Okay. Clark's a pretty common name.
Yeah, yeah. I've known quite a few Clarks growing up as well, and I don't think they were related to each other either. So we're here to talk about Chapter 5, The Gunslinger of The Mandalorian on Disney Plus. This one is directed by Dave Filoni and written by Dave Filoni. For those of you who aren't familiar, he also did The Clone Wars and the Rebels, Star Wars Rebels. And that's about it for non-spoiler stuff. So if you haven't seen the chapter yet, you might want to pause and come back after you've seen Chapter 5, because we go straight into spoilers on this show. Really quick, last week we talked about The Mandalorian being the number one downloaded show in the U.S., this week it was announced it's now the number one downloaded show in the world. Any surprises there, Jason?
Sorry, that was the dog.
I thought you were spray painting something there.
The dog is spray painting something.
Yeah, the dog's spray painting something.
He's tagging the walls of my house because he's not getting attention.
Exactly. He's a regular Sabine, that guy.
No surprise here. I knew this was going to be big. This is about what I expected from the show.
How about you, Scott?
No, I agree. You know, the way that all the hype was coming and people talking about it, it's no surprise to me. It's the number one show.
And Justin, same thing?
Oh, yeah. It's Disney. It's Star Wars. How could it? And it's a great show. They're doing a great job with it. So I'm not surprised.
Okay, see, maybe because I'm not from the U.S., I'm surprised, because Disney Plus isn't available in that many countries right now. And for it to be the number one downloaded show in the world is kind of surprising to me, really, with Netflix having their Christmas movies and whatnot coming out right now. And everyone in the world just about gets Netflix. I'm really shocked, but this goes to show. And you know what? Honestly, I don't think the rest of the world has caught up to the U.S. yet in downloading. I think that the numbers in the U.S. are so huge compared to everyone else. I think it's pretty very, very common in the U.S. to have people have streaming services and downloads, where even like people I work with, there's a lot of them that don't have Netflix, don't have any streaming devices in their house. So that could be a big part of it. But anyways, it's interesting to think about. So this this chapter starts off with the gunslinger, with the Mandalorian flying through space and another ship chasing after him, shooting at him. And I mean, I'm excited to see a dogfight in space again, but honestly, this didn't feel Star Wars to me, this whole scene. It felt more like, I don't know, like one of those older movies from the 70s that would be like The Last Rocketeer or something like that, or whatever. Did you guys feel this was a Star Wars scene at all? Dustin, you're looking at me funny. Or Jason. Justin. Justin, you're looking at me kind of funny there.
Pick a name. Any name.
Okay. Yeah.
Justin. No, I thought it was fine. And I was excited to see a space battle in The Mandalorian finally.
Yeah, true enough. And how about you, Scott? You got a kind of perplexed look.
No, I enjoyed it. This is what Star Wars was about, you know, the space battle, the dogfights. So I enjoyed it finally being into the show. So,
okay. Jason, you say same thing, you liked it?
I loved it. It was like a Bond cold opening, but for this episode. I think they should do one for every episode where they just got like some little adventure going on that has nothing to do with the rest of the story.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, it did kind of, yeah, exactly. It had nothing to do with the story other than his ship getting damaged and having to go somewhere. And then we got that line again. He goes, I could bring you in cold or I could bring you in warm. And the Mando, that was it. That was like the straw that broke the camel's back. The Mando is now, okay, that's my line. You know, it's one thing to shoot at me. It's another thing to steal my line. So he slams on the brakes or maybe he just got damaged. I couldn't really tell. You know, the ship, they just described him as man in the, as far as I could tell, in the other ship, you know, goes past him and that was the end of it.
Yeah, a couple of things there. The tracking system is the same that we saw in like A New Hope and such.
Yeah, yeah.
But also, when he contacts the tower, the guy doing the voice saying Mos Eisley Tower is Steve Bloom, who did the voice of Zeb in Rebels.
Oh, cool! I didn't catch that. Oh, that's neat. Yeah. So he's badly damaged. He's leaking fuel. He's in the middle of space out of nowhere, but of course off to his right there's a planet because this is Star Wars. There's always a planet nearby where you can, you know, you can end up going. And yeah, so like Justin was saying, he contacts the tower. And so they tell him to go to Docking Bay 35 at Mos Espa.
Mos Eisley. Now,
Mos Eisley. So, of course, we're all familiar with Tatooine. We're all familiar from A New Hope. Luke Skywalker describes it as if there's a bright center of the universe, this is the planet that's furthest from. So it's probably a good place, you know, for smuggler bounty hunters to hide out. It's not known to be a very, it's way out in the outer rim. What I thought was kind of, now, if you're coming into Earth and you're going to California because you want to go visit Disneyland in California, the original home of Walt, and the Paris Tower contacts you and tells you to land in Paris. am I wrong in thinking like, is every planet only have one city in Star Wars? Like, did you find that weird or am I the only one? Scott?
I think they have a limited number of space ports per city. So like on Sorgan last week, there was the one space port that everyone lands at, but then the rest of the planet is not as populated, so they didn't have the need for more than one.
I mean, he could land his ship anywhere on that planet, really. I mean, I guess the tower told him to land there. Scott, did you find that like?
No, I kind of agree with Justin. I think it depends on the planet's population. You know, as Tatooine, you figure, you know, it's not as populated as, say, some of the bigger planets.
Like Naboo or something like that, or Coruscant.
On top of that, the spaceport is more likely to have a place he can get repairs done.
Well, yeah, I mean, it worked out good for him in the end. Like that's what he was going for. But it just seems like if I'm coming from Mars and I want to go visit California, I don't want to land in Paris. I want to land in California. You know, it just seemed very unusual. So he gets to the lands and we. Finally, we're introduced to a new character. Was it Pelimoto?
Pelimoto.
Pelimoto.
By Amy Sedaris.
Right. So when she yells, hey, and we see the back of her head, I immediately thought Rhea Perlman from Cheers. Jason, you're laughing. Did you think that too?
I thought the same thing. I thought that this is Carla in space.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I thought the same thing immediately. I thought
I thought it was Ripley from Aliens.
Okay, yeah, I can see that also.
I thought of Ripley as well, and other people have mentioned Dana Barrett from Ghostbusters. He's also having that kind of wild hair like that.
Yeah, yeah. I saw Rhea Perlman, and when she walked out, I'm like, well, Rhea Perlman, she doesn't look too bad. Well, things considered. So then she's like this space mechanic. Works on spaceships, as star cruisers, And she's like, 90% of the mechanics that I've had to deal with in my life, where she's pointing out everything that's wrong with the Razor Crest. I need a special tool for this. You got carbon scoring. I got to rotate that. You're leaking fuel. You have screw. And then what does she say, Justin, about the scorch marks?
Well, she says you got a lot of carbon scoring here. I wouldn't be surprised if you haven't been in a space fight.
Yeah, of course. And then we're familiar with carbon scoring from R2 having carbon scoring when Luke was cleaning him, saying you guys must have seen a lot of action. Before that happens, I like the pit droids came running out to greet him right away. And he fires one shot and they right away clam up. So it turns out there's two ways to close up pit droids. So you can punch them in the nose, like how Anakin told Jar Jar to do in episode one, or you can shoot at them and then they clam up right away.
I call them stooge droids myself because they act like the Three Stooges.
Yeah, yeah. So true to his form, he doesn't want any droids working on his ship. So he tells her, no droids, fix the ship. I'll get you the money. Don't worry about it. Yeah, she's heard that before. So he heads out.
Now, I want to pause right there for a moment because I was a little confused by that. He left Baby Yoda all alone, sleeping on the ship, and goes running off. No, doesn't even let anyone know that he's there or anything. He doesn't ask Pelly to watch after the kid or anything. He's just like, kid's asleep. Well, I'll just leave him here.
Yeah, he kind of like
he knows that there are bounty hunters after them.
Yeah, you're right.
And he's expecting there to be a bounty guild on Tatooine.
Jason.
I that was something stuck in my cry, but you can't be that bad a person that you'll just leave a baby locked in a closet and go somewhere, will you?
Well, like that's just it. Like it was uncharacteristic.
He locked the baby in the broom closet and went, and not only did he lock the baby in the closet, he went to the bar afterwards.
Yeah, somebody needs to call child services like immediately.
He is a bad parent.
yeah, no kidding. At least
take the baby to the bar.
yeah, exactly. So when he leaves, carved in the wall, there was the 35 in a kind of a very distinct font. And that harkens back to A New Hope when the Millennium Falcon was docked at Docking Bay 94 on Tatooine. And it had the 94 carved into the wall. In the background, if you look closely, you'll see it. It's the exact same font. I thought that was a cool shutout. Just that little those details there. So I did notice when he headed out, not only did he leave Baby Yoda locked in the closet, he didn't bring his rifle with him. I thought that was kind of unusual as well. Scott, did you catch that?
No, I didn't catch the rifle part. You know, but I'm agreeing with you guys. Is what he has all these bounty hunters after Baby Yoda and just leaves them in. I just don't get it. You know, you keep him by your side the whole time. You know, I think he would have learned his lesson by now that there is nowhere that he's going to be able to hide.
Yeah, exactly. So I don't know why he left his rifle behind. At the end of the show, when they show the pictures, in every one of those pictures, he had his rifle with him. So for whatever reason, they made a choice for it. I guess he didn't need it in the show. Maybe it's awkward to ride a speeder with a rifle. I have no idea. So he takes off, he walks past those stormtroopers with the spikes, their helmets on the spikes. I thought that was a cool scene. I love all the walking scenes, like just with the music playing and him walking, or just like scenery scenes. I love all of those. I noticed that a lot of those helmets had blunt injuries in them. Like the helmets were cracked or they had like an axe mark in the helmets type of thing. Like it looked like as if the locals revolted after the Empire fell and took down the stormtroopers by any means necessary.
If they heads on a stick didn't imply that they rebelled against everyone. I don't know what does.
So then we cut back to Pally playing cards with some pit droids, and they're gambling with parts. She's raising a motivator. Did you catch that the pit droids were cheating?
Yeah, passing a card off.
Yeah, yeah. They're under the table. They're passing cards to each other. I love that. I thought that was. I think
they're specifically playing Sabacc, which is what they were playing in Solo, A Star Wars Story.
Yeah, exactly. So, I thought that was hilarious. That little pass under the table. So they hear kind of a scream and like a bang or a thud or something come from the Razor Crest. And I love that one of the pit droids imitated the scream, like right after they hear it. they hear Baby Yoda kind of yell out, and one of the pit droids repeats it. Like, I thought that was hilarious.
And is that supposed to be a callback to the same sort of scream that Obi-Wan used to scare away the Tusken Raiders back in A New Hope?
I didn't catch that being that. I just
think that's what I thought it was.
Okay.
A little Easter egg.
I just took it as
this whole show boldly asked the question, can there be too much fan service?
There is so much, like every minute, at least. There's probably even more than that. It's probably more than 30. It's a 35-minute show. It's probably more than 35 little tidbits that harken back to previous shows. And the pit droids, the way they were looking around, I thought that was great. I really enjoyed the pit droids in this chapter. So Mando we cut back to Mando, and she gets the baby and decides that she's going to babysit it and charge Mando for babysitting services as well as fixing his ship. So this bill is just racking up there quickly.
But at least someone's looking after Baby Yoda now.
No kidding. A bounty hunter would have no problem taking that thing away from her, I'm pretty sure. So Mando gets to the cantina, and this is the exact same cantina where we first meet our heroes in A New Hope with Chewbacca and Han and Obi-Wan and Lucan. You could tell it's the same cantina because before he enters, they show the exterior of it, and there's like a damaged, I'm not sure if it's a building or a satellite dish. It almost looks like the roof of a building turned sideways, like one of those dome-shaped buildings that's smashed there. It's the exact same damaged building that's outside the original cantina. The little stuff that was garbage that was on the right hand side has been cleaned up. I noticed when he walked in, the droid detector was missing. I caught that right away. And if you go to Olga's cantina at Galaxy's Edge, the droid detector is there. They have one there when you first walk into Olga's cantina. There's a droid detector going. Now there was none there, and there's a good reason for it. Because the cantina now welcomes droids.
The cantina is now run by droids.
Yeah.
Yeah. Scott?
Yeah, the bartender is a droid.
Yeah.
There's two of them, actually, and they're both the EV series ones that we saw from Return of the Jedi.
Yeah.
There was one in Jabba's Palace, I believe.
And there's an R5 unit serving drinks, it looked like. I'm assuming that was serving. Now, is that R5-D4?
I've seen some people suggest that that's what they think. They think it's that R5-D4 specifically from A New Hope.
Yeah, so he got his motivator fixed, and his red has all faded in the Tatooine desert suns. Now, my understanding is on R5-D4 ends up being in possession of a Hondo in Galaxy's Edge. And that you see that droid with the kind of like the teeth painted on it.
Mm-hmm.
That's Disney confirmed that was R5-D4. Before you enter Smuggler's Run, so I kind of want to hear the story of R5 now. He seems like he's had a bit of a life. He's been Tatooine for years and years, and all of a sudden he ends up on Batuu. So he approaches the droid barkeeper and says he's a hunter looking for work, and he says there's no more guild here on Tatooine. I guess back in the day when the Hutts controlled Tatooine, the guild was quite prevalent. I mean, there were bounty hunters all over the place on Tatooine, and now they're few and far between. Are we going to just chalk that up as because after Jabba died, that was the end of the Hutts being in Tatooine?
Yeah, that's what I would think. You know, with Jabba gone, you know, and I'm sure the Scarlet pick probably scared him off too, killing a few of those bounty hunters that was on the ship.
Yeah. It was. That's kind of the impression that I got, that after that was the end of Jabba, that kind of put the end of the, there was no longer like on episode one, or sorry, chapter one, the guy that was handing out the pucks. I'm guessing Jabba was kind of like that guy. So if he's gone, there's nobody handing out pucks in. But you think somebody would replace him, but it seems like the huts are gone and everyone is gone. So we meet Tordo Calican. Did I pronounce it right, Justin?
Toro, I think, is what I had written down.
Toro Calican. So he wants to get in the guild, and he has a puck, and he has some work, and he needs some help. He starts off acting like he's the age-old bounty hunter. He's not as he pretended to be, but he's looking for Fennel Shand.
Fennec Shand.
Fennec. You know what? I wrote an L.
Shand.
Yeah. So she's an assassin, and she's been on the run since the New Republic has put all her employers on lockdown. So,
and not just any old assassin, an elite mercenary who's worked for all the top crime syndicates.
Including the Hutts.
Including the Hutts.
Yeah. So it sounds like the New Republic is trying to clean up a lot of things now that they're in power. Not only did they get rid of the Empire, now they're kind of going after the crime syndicate as well. The impression I got, Jason, did you get that impression?
That they're going around cleaning up?
The New Republic is kind of cleaning up. They got rid of the Imperials, and now they're kind of going after the criminal syndicate.
Kind of, but I like how it's been kind of kept vague as far as what they're up to. We know that they've been going around cleaning up, and we know from Kara, the last one, that doesn't mean a nice thing.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
So it's a slow world building that I'm getting into.
Yeah, and that's what I'm loving, is these little tidbits that we're getting. They're just kind of like through conversations of different things. So Mondo says, okay, I'll take the job. We'll go get your bounty together, and Mondo's going to keep the pay, and he's going to use this as his check mark to get into the guild. So he goes back to the Razor Crest. Of course, Baby Yoda's no longer in the closet, so to speak. So he kind of freaks out, and Rhea Perlman is sleeping while she's watching Baby Yoda. And I like how she wakes up and she goes, I'm awake, I'm awake. I'm not sleeping. So Toro comes back. He has two speeder bikes ready to go out into the desert sands of Tatooine to look for Fennec. They're racing through the desert sands. They come across sand people, which is, of course, from episode one and episode three. And it was kind of interesting how he... like rather than just shoot them down, he, you know, negotiated with them. Was that kind of a surprising tactic, Justin?
Well, he also mentions that they consider themselves to be the natives and everyone else is trespassers, which I thought was kind of neat. So it's kind of, you know, taking this as, you know, the Western, he's kind of comparing them then to the Indians from the old Westerns.
Yeah, yeah,
but
exactly.
I think that was part of what they were going for with that. So yeah, that was... so he starts negotiating with him, and I was happy to see that. That was kind of an interesting way to go about this, and shows a little bit more that he knows that he's both familiar with this culture, and that he's more experienced in how do you get from one place to another in these sort of situations. It's easier to negotiate than to shoot down everyone.
Yeah, it sort of shows his experience, his maturity in that sense. So they negotiate, gives him the guy's brand new binocs, which are, you know, Star Wars binoculars, and they are given free passage through the Tusken Raider territory. They come across a Dewback walking through the sand, dragging a bounty hunter behind it. Well, we don't know at the time, but we find out later it's a bounty hunter. So Mando goes out to check to see, you know, maybe this is our bounty. Maybe this is who we're looking for. And he gets shot twice while he's doing this reconnaissance mission. So the Baskar holds up. I like the line, Scott, where he says, Toro says, but I don't have any Baskar. And his response was,
yes,
Yep.
And he goes, nope, you don't have any. So I thought that was kind of cool. So they decide to wait till nightfall, and they wait until after Krennic falls asleep. Is it Krennic? I can't pronounce her name.
Fennec.
Fennec falls asleep. That little thing, though, was Mando actually asleep, or was he just seeing what Toro would do when he was kind of playing with his gun and pointing it at him? What did you guys think?
I think he was watching the whole time.
You think he was watching? Yeah. What did you think, Scott?
Yeah, I think he was watching.
Just yeah. The,
you know, he can't sit there and sleep and let everything go by. I think he was just sitting there, staying quiet, just surveying everything.
probably was watching like some movies on his visor. He has like he has like an iPad built into his visor there, and he can watch. It looks like an IMAX screen when it's that close.
He's cleaning out his inbox the whole time.
yeah, exactly. He has little controls in his gauntlet. So he has this great plan. We're going to go as fast as we can straight to her, and we'll shoot these flashes off that will blind her scope, and we'll get to her. She won't be able to see us, but we'll get to her no problem if we're lucky, is basically the plan. So the first flash works really well. Mondo shoots it off. Toro shoots his off, no problem. Mondo, I think he shoots his second one. And then Toro kind of hits a bump, and it causes his flash to go, rather than going up into the sky to blind her, kind of goes into the ground and scoots around the ground. And this allows Fennec to shoot Mondo's speeder. So, I mean, it was great taking this kid on. I mean, he would have been better off doing the shooting the flashes himself, but I guess he was trying to teach his kid something too. They're saying, here, you shoot every other one. I don't know why he didn't just shoot them all himself. It would have been no problem. But anyway, so Toro gets to Fennec. They have a little hand-to-hand battle. Anything interesting here you guys wanted to talk about?
Well, I do want to say that Ming-Na Wen is 56 years old, and she still kicks butt.
Is she really?
Yeah, you wouldn't know that. She is still in her prime. She's an amazing woman.
No kidding. So Mando sneaks up behind, gets her to put the binders on, and she sits up and she says, it's been a long time since I've seen a Mandalorian, or one of your kind, I believe it was, she says. Now, she used to work for the Hutts. She's hiding out at Tatooine. She's familiar with Mandalorians. It's been a long time since she saw one. Is she talking about Boba Fett? Is that she's talking about the last time she saw? Or were they more prevalent in the past? Jason?
I don't know, but that was a question I had during this episode. Is everyone just calls him Mondo? Is that what they call all Mandalorians? Or is that his name?
I think so. I think they don't have, yeah. Like if you see a nun, you would call her sister.
Right.
Even if you don't know her name. You know, I think it's kind of like that. Does that make sense? That's all I'm guessing. I could be way off.
They also finally mentioned the name of the planet from chapters 1 and 3, where he met the client and got his bounty puck. It's Nevorro.
Right. Yes, we did get that planet name. And obviously news travels fast because she knew the whole backstory and everything. She was very familiar with what happened on what was it, for Nevorro?
Nevorro.
Nevorro?
N-A-V-R-R-O.
Yeah. So, turns out they only have one speeder bike now because she blasted one of them. I don't know why they didn't just drag her behind like he suggested, but instead he decides to go out on another quest to go look for this dude back. So while he's gone at night looking for the dude back with his visor, which makes more sense for him to find it, I think, because he can actually see in the dark. She tells him the whole story of Vando being at large and everyone's looking for him. He'd get in the guild really quick if you bring him in instead of me. He asks, how can we be sure she's the one, that he's the one, he's the Mando everyone's looking for. She mentions that, well, it's been told that she has a child. Now, was that kind of like what finally made him decide that she was the one, or he was the Mando everyone's looking for?
He had seen the child when he was dropping off the speeder, showing up at the speeder bikes back at the hangar.
Yeah.
And at the time, he hadn't thought anything of it. So I think that was what made him go, yeah, this would be the one then, because he did have a child with him.
Yeah. Plus, not only that, like when he came to the cantina, he was looking for non-guild work. So he kind of, you know, one and one, we got the child, we got the guy looking for, he's a bounty hunter, but doesn't want to work for guild work. You know, it kind of adds up. So he gets up. I thought he was going to let her go. Did everyone else think he was going to let her go?
Well, I know Ming-Na Wen from Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., so I was kind of rooting for Agent May here. But I was like, yeah, let her go. Come on.
I was kind of shocked when he just turned and just blasted her right in the stomach like that. I thought he would let her go, then she would go and kill him. That's kind of what I thought.
Yeah, that's kind of what I was looking at happening as well.
And apparently he thought the same thing.
Yeah, so, Jason?
See, I thought Mando was going to kill both of them. They were going to team up against him, and that he was going to have to take both of them down at the same time.
Okay. That would have made sense also as well. Well, he shoots her cold-blooded right in the gut, murders her on the spot. And I like that because it really reminded me of A New Hope and Han shot only. Because that was the whole, like, I'm not a hater of the special editions at all, but I do really dislike that scene that they took out where Han shot Greedo without even giving Greedo a chance to cock his gun.
It reminded me of Solo when Han shoots Beckett at the end.
Yeah, exactly. And it's a character trait in that, like, shoot first and ask questions later. It just bothers me, that scene of Han and Greedo.
But Stan, now we get him saying McClunky.
Yeah, I know. It makes it even
because
worse.
That clears everything up.
Exactly.
Yeah. So Mondo gets back and she's dead and the speeder bike's gone. So he has his dude back. So he starts heading back into town. Like, what other choices does he have? And so this was early in the morning that she gets shot. I'm not sure how long it was still daylight when he came back and found her dead. So he has to head back. It's now nighttime when he gets back to town.
Yeah, those dewbacks are a little slower than the speeder bikes.
Yeah, no kidding. He gets back to his Bay 35, and Toro leaves the speeder bike right by the door. That's a bit of a rookie mistake if I've ever seen one. Like, talk about losing your element of surprise. So Toro comes out of the he obviously knows that he's there and there's no chance of element of surprise. Toro comes out holding the gun, holding Baby Yoda in one hand and, you know, making Rhea Perlman. What's her name?
Sully.
Sully. Sully pointing her at gunshot. He tells her to go put the binders on. I like the line where she says, you're smarter than you look. And she sees a flash charge behind his head. So he shoots off one of these flashes, blinds Toro, goes off to the side and shoots him. Problem solved. Baby Yoda goes wherever, behind a crate, wherever he got there.
Yeah, I was a little disappointed. I was kind of almost wishing that Toro would stick around as well, just because it would be interesting for him to, instead of dying here, if he could have come back later, as a more experienced bounty hunter after having been mentored by the Mando in the first place. But that's not the way they went.
Yeah, no, I'm glad he's gone. I wasn't a big fan of this character.
But it goes back to that world building I was talking about. This is a dangerous universe.
Yeah. No,
the downside to being dumb in that profession.
Yeah. I'm kind of glad that he's gone. And it kind of shows like one little slip up and that's, you know, you're done for in this universe.
Well, the thing too is, if you're going to become a bounty hunter, don't you think you'd be mentored by a bounty hunter and have some insight in it and with some skills? This guy had pretty much nothing.
Yeah. You
know, he had some money and that was about it to look the part, but he didn't know how to play the part.
Yeah, he could talk the talk, but not walk the walk, as they would say.
I've seen him referred to as the anti-Baby Yoda because everyone wanted him dead.
Yes, exactly. So Mondo takes his wallet from him and gives all the money to Rhea. What's her name?
Felly.
Space Carla.
Space Carla. And he says, well, this cover. Now, did he overpay her, or was that enough? Because it looked like initially she was going to like just let him go without paying. So did he end up paying her too much, or was that not enough? And she's, right, well, that's good enough.
I think he overpaid. That's what I got out of it.
Yeah.
See, the first time I watched it, that's what I thought. He overpaid. But then when I kind of watched it the second time, it almost looked like it wasn't quite enough. But she was like, yeah, this is good enough. But I think in the end, he overpaid her. I think she was quite happy with the negotiation. And she got really attached to young Yoda because she was going to miss him when he was getting ready to leave.
And she calls out Mando on being a bad parent.
Yeah.
You've got a lot to learn about raising a young one.
Yeah, no kidding. I like how she tells the pit droids to take Toro out to Beggar's Canyon just to drag him out there to get rid of the body.
Another location name drop.
Yeah, yeah. So I guess now he's Womp Rat Food out in Beggar's Canyon, because we know that they're prevalent out there. Go ahead, Jason.
Gonna say we're gonna need like a Star Wars name drop bingo game.
Yeah. Yeah, no kidding. I thought Pelly was a great character. I'd like to see her come back. I like it that we're getting to see real people in the Star Wars universe, kind of like for the first time almost. Like we're getting backstories of just everyday, you know, people. I guess Watto kind of would have been like that. What did you guys think of this show, this chapter as a whole, Jason?
I love this one. This was the most Western episode yet for me. And I guess this is why I'm fine with characters not coming back, because this is the Traveler, the old 50s show where he goes town to town and meets new people every time.
Okay. And Scott?
I enjoyed it, but I don't think it was the best one out of the bunch or out of the group. It was still good, but it was towards the bottom out of the five previous episodes to me.
Yeah, no, I agree with you, Scott. I thought it was a filler episode. And last week's, like, let's face it, was also a bit of a filler episode. I mean, at least with last week, he got a few more allies in the end. Whereas this one, he's back to where he started. How about you, Jason? Justin?
I did like a lot of the callbacks to various bits of Tatooine that we've heard of before. That was a lot of fun, but in the end, that's kind of all this episode was just, it seemed like it was almost all an excuse to, let's mention this thing from Tatooine, let's mention this thing from Star Wars, let's mention this thing from Solo or whatever.
Yeah.
And like you say, there wasn't really much to the overall story that we got other than that last little stinger scene.
Yeah. Like, so Dave Filoni's writing this going, the fans will like this.
Fans will get a kick out of pit droids.
Can you do an entire episode as Dave Filoni?
Yeah. They're gonna like Mos Espa. Name drop.
Jason, what are you gonna say?
I did really like this episode. This was the one I said this would be my what I watch on a plane episode. The one you can take out from any season, and it has nothing to do with the rest of the series, and it's just one you can watch as a single story and be done with.
Okay. And now Jason or Justin mentioned the cliffhanger at the end. I wanted to save that for the end. Who do we think that is, or is it nobody? To me, it looked like it was another Mando that was kind of following him. Justin, you can go first.
I think it's definitely going to be someone that we're going to see in a future chapter here.
Oh yeah, met them already? Is it someone we've met already?
One of the theories I've read and seen is that it could be Boba Fett himself, because apparently in the Legends materials, he escapes the Sarlacc pit and repairs his jetpack and is would therefore be, you know, hanging around Tatooine. In which case we probably won't see him until chapter 8.
Yeah. Yeah, as a cliffhanger probably in chapter 8.
And part of that is exactly, you know, he has the cape, he has what looks like Mandalorian armor, and he has the spurs that we would hear on Boba Fett when he was walking around in the movies.
Okay. Scott, how about you?
I kind of agree with what Justin just said. I would think it would be Boba Fett, but then I think that's the easy answer there. So I am not too sure.
Okay.
I think we're supposed to at least think of that as an option.
Exactly. I think that's the easy choice right there to think it's Boba Fett.
That's what I'm kind of thinking also. Jason, how about you?
Well, it was such an easy choice. I thought, oh, please don't let that be Boba Fett.
That was my thought also. I don't want it to be Boba Fett. I mean, if it is, it is. I'm not going to be angry or anything, but I kind of don't want it to be Boba Fett. How about Sabine? Could it be Sabine? She's kind of older now. She'd be in that right age. Or it could be someone we've never met yet. Or it could be the heavy gunner that we saw.
There's another possibility that I had read about, which comes from the Aftermath trilogy of books. There's apparently a guy on Tatooine in those books who gets hold of Mandalorian armor. His name is Cobb Vanth.
Mm-hmm.
And he becomes a sheriff of the one city on Tatooine called Freetown.
Okay, that I would go along with.
That would be a deep cut, as it were, from some of the books that they're more canon books, apparently. They're part of the run-up to The Force Awakens.
Okay. Or how about the blacksmith, Mandalorian, Mando? What was her name? We've seen her in two chapters. The armorer, I think they called her.
Armorer, yeah.
Jason?
Speaking of deep cuts, I actually had the thought of, okay, what if that's like Dash Rendar?
I think you're going to have to explain Dash Rendar.
Shadows
okay.
of
Shadows of the Empire. Okay. Video game reference, I'm out.
Book and video game. Book, comic, and video game. And soundtrack and action figures.
Okay. Oh, right. Okay. Shadow. Yes, yes. Now I'm familiar. It'd be interesting to see. So where's he off to now? Is he going to, where is he headed? Let's take wild guesses. Where is he? What's his next port of call? Everyone's shaking their heads. They haven't got a clue.
Well, there's nothing in this episode to give us any indication of what's going to come next for him, other than he's going to do the have gun will travel thing and set down on another planet, have another adventure.
Yeah, another desolate planet trying to run from the bounty hunters.
Could he be going to Dagobah? Could he get word that there used to be a same species character that used to live on Dagobah that is the Baby Yoda character?
I don't see them going there until maybe the next season, if that's even a possibility.
Yeah.
He's off to Batuu so they can film an episode there.
Oh, that'd be a good point. Yeah. Yeah, that's a good point. I'd like to see him go to Dagobah. Justin, you're shaking your head.
No, I was just thinking, I was agreeing with Jason that, going to the Black Spire Outpost, if they didn't do that, that's almost a missed opportunity, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I definitely see him doing that here in some future episodes, at least making a stop there.
If they don't make a spot, they're going to make a reference. At some point, they're going to say, that's the same thing that happened back on Batuu. It's going to come up at some point for sure. That's pretty much a given, I think. So with that, we had a great show, guys. It's been fun as always. See you all next week and hardly wait for chapter 6. And with that, Ken, take it away.
If you would like to keep the adventure going after the show, be sure to like our Facebook friends page, Grand Circle Tour Magical Ticket Holders. While on Facebook, like our group page, Grand Circle Tour. Be sure to follow us on Twitter, Grand Circle Tour Podcast, as well as Instagram, GCT Podcast, and our YouTube channel, Grand Circle Tour. If you would like to send us a message, you can email us at gctpodcast@gmail.com. T-shirts and other fun merchandise can be found at tpublic.com. Simply search Grand Circle Tour Podcast. If you enjoyed your adventure, leave us a review on Apple Podcast. Only one rule, make it good. Thank you for riding with us, and welcome home.